Hello and a very warm welcome. You're watching the brand new edition of To The Point with your host, Kriti Mishra. And on today's show, I have a very special guest, National Health Authority CEO, Mr. Arish Sharma. Sir, welcome to Raj Sabha TV and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me on your platform, Kriti.
Sir, a liberalized and accelerated phase 3 strategy of COVID-19 vaccination. It is being implemented from 1st of May 2021. Registration for the new eligible population groups commenced on 28th of April from 4 p.m. How has been the response?
The response has been very, very overwhelming. We had not expected that many number of registrations. So just to give you a bit of a statistics, on an average, we were looking at registrations of, 20 lakhs, 25 lakh per day. Now, when we opened it up on 28th at 4 p.m., from 4 p.m. till 12 in that night, we got 1.37 crore registrations on our platform, 113.7 million. Similarly, yesterday also we thought that after the first day, the numbers will go down. But yesterday also we recorded 1 crore 5 lakh registrations. So I think there is a huge amount of enthusiasm in people of especially of 18 to 44 years of age to register on the platform. Of course, the vaccination in that liberal, third phase, as we call it, starting from 1st of May, that is tomorrow, will basically happen. And then as and when the states or the private hospitals get the vaccines, and then they publish it on our platform, the slots will start becoming visible for people and then they can make the booking. So this is how it is happening. As far as the bookings or vaccination of 45 years plus is concerned, it's continuing. It will continue certainly in future also, which is free and provided by Government of India at the state and central government hospitals. So that's the status as of now.
So as the registration process commenced for the phase 3 driver vaccination, there were several media reports citing technical glitches. How do you respond to that?
Well, the unfortunate part is that sometimes media jumps to conclusions too fast. Some, for example, we have actually done thus far, let me show you, I think it's about 3 crore, SMS were actually, OTPs were released on the first day, 8 hours, which is 4 p.m. to 12. And these 3 crores SMS, 98.7% SMSs were delivered within 50 seconds. Now, maybe some people, that 1%, people may have got their OTPs a little later. It may have been, in 1 minute or 1.5 minutes. Now, somehow, some people, those who did not get it in time and within 15 seconds, they obviously tweeted and then, the whole media went and said that, the whole thing has crashed or has become absolutely slow. The OTPs are not being delivered. Now, imagine 1.37 crore registration in a matter of 8 hours is a huge, huge number. If you divide it by 8, it's about 17 lakhs registrations per hour, and 17 lakh registrations per hour translates to about 35,000 to 4,000 registrations per minute. And that translates again to some few hundred registrations per second. So that could not have happened if you were not getting the OTPs or if people are not able to register. So there have been absolutely no glitches. Unfortunately, glitches and crash are two, common words which typically media associates with all the government applications, and therefore they also immediately cried that it is crashed or there are glitches. There are absolutely no glitches. In fact, there have been no glitches in the COVID software since the beginning itself, except in the few days when the Honorable PM launched it on 16th of January. And when we started this COVID software, there were initially a couple of problems, and those were ironed out in the first 5-6 days. And thereafter, there have been no problem. In fact, there have been a huge upgradations in the software. Now we are able to show vacancies. We are able to show a number of you know, centers and everything. So now with the, and especially the complexity has also increased. Now you are going to have 18 to 44 years also added to the thing. You are now going to have more and more vaccines added to the platform. So I think there are a lot of other, you know, sort of the software is becoming more complex. Notwithstanding that, the software has performed extremely well in terms of scale, in terms of numbers, and in terms of response time.
All right, sir. The fact that it is the largest vaccination drive probably anywhere in the world, I'd just like to understand what went into the preparations.
See, the point is that we had a, you know, we had some basic overarching principles, which actually we had learned from projects like Aadhaar or UPI. You know, Aadhaar is a project which dealt with scale. It dealt with speed. It dealt with simplicity. So basically we said that let us make the software which is easy to use by the citizens, which is easy to scale, which actually gives maximum freedom to the people. You know, software is after all made for people and facilitating people's lives. It's not made for complicating their lives. Therefore, the basic principles which we adopted was simplicity, scalability, ease of use, inclusiveness. So for example, on one mobile phone, you can register four people. So it's not necessary that everybody in the house has a mobile phone. So inclusiveness. We also said that those people who do not have the mobile phone and are unable to register, we have made provisions for walk-ins, which means you can just go and walk in and get yourself vaccinated. So therefore, what is actually done and you know, freedom to the extent that it is not necessary that when you get first vaccine at center A, then you have to get your second jab also at center A only. You can go to any center in the whole country, not even state. You know, you can, you know, suppose you are in today in Delhi, and for the second jab, you have to go to Trivandrum, and that time that jab, you know, your timetable falls or that schedule falls. You can get yourself vaccinated, registered, seek appointment in Trivandrum. So this is the kind of freedom which has been provided to people. Obviously, the software also takes care of the fact that when you have been vaccinated with vaccine X in the first instance, you shall be vaccinated at vaccine X only in the second phase. It is unique to our country that we are issuing digitally verifiable certificates, both after the first jab and also after the second jab, the final certificate. So basically, you can show these certificates. These certificates are verifiable digitally. You can read the QR code and you can get the certificates to prove that this person has indeed been vaccinated. And when you go for the second jab, you can show your first certificate, which will ensure that you get the only the same vaccine which you were given in the first place. So I think the whole, you know, approach has been of simplicity, of extendability, of inclusiveness, and of scale.
All right, sir. We'll get into the specifics of phase three just a bit. But it'll be interesting to know, how did you ramp up the capacity of the servers and other parameters to match this unprecedented scale of immunization, probably anywhere in the world?
Well, Kriti, I think that's a very important question. What we do is, once we make the software, then first of all, we test it. When you test it, basically you look for bugs, you look for any glitches, you look for any potential problems. Then what you do is basically you do a load testing. So basically, I mean, just to give you an example, we had tested the load at 45,000 hits per second, our server. Now, interestingly, on the first day, which is the day for yesterday at 4 p.m., we were getting a hits of 55,000 per second. So this actually, the load testing was only for 45,000. The hits were 55,000. So basically they were more than the load tested, but still they were not so large. They were not multiple times. They were just about 20% more. And therefore we were able to take the load. So load testing. Another principle, which is actually we have employed in software development, is that it should be loosely coupled. So just to give you an idea, this software has got four major components. One major component is registration and appointment, which is basically citizen facing. So citizen can use that software piece, and that is an application that is on Arogya Setu, as also on the portal. You can make appointments and register yourself. Second actually piece is the facility management piece for the hospitals, because ultimately people will be able to make registration only when hospitals publish their schedules and their vacancies. Then and only then people can make appointments. Unless you publish the train timetable, people cannot make reservations on those trains, right? So that actually is the publication. And this time around, now they will publish even not only the timetable, but also the vaccine type and the prices of those vaccines, because now the vaccines are going to be priced differently in private sector, in public sector, and stuff like that. So that's the second component. The third component is basically vaccination component, which means that when you vaccinate, at that time you check the identity of the person who is being vaccinated, and then you vaccinate, and then you put down the batch number of the vaccine and the vaccine type, and that's the third component, and you upload that data. The fourth component is basically issuance of the digital certificate. That digital certificate, which we vaccine certificate, which we issue, that is the fourth component. So as soon as the system gets the data of the vaccination, then the system informs and issues a certificate. In between, these systems are connected to SMSs. So basically you have an OTP or an SMS. When you are vaccinated, you get an SMS saying that you have been vaccinated, your second jab is due after so many days, and stuff like that. All these four components are actually loosely coupled through APIs. APIs are essentially like connectors, and these can always be decoupled. Decoupled in the sense that one can have third party applications they can develop and they can plug into this whole system. So for example, since yesterday, we have now put on the COVID portal a facility where without logging, you can just search the hospitals and their vacancies. Otherwise, you have to, for finding out whether there are vacancies available near you, you have to log into your account. Now you don't need to do that. Similarly, you can download your vaccination certificate after OTP verification, even without logging into the system. So these two parts, they will now be developed as third-party applications, and they will be able to plug into our system. Similarly, we will have probably vaccination also, appointment registration also, they can also become third-party applications after we notify the policy in a couple of days. So that's the whole architecture is made into that kind of simplified architecture, which is robust. At the same time, it is not complex, monolithic.
But Mr.
Sharma, very long answer, but I hope your
yes,
your
sir, absolutely. But I'm still intrigued, and I would like to know 55,000 hits per second.
Yes.
That kind of traffic, yes, and that kind of preparation.
It's actually unusual because 55,000 hits per second, and you know, it should be probably a record. I have not seen the record, but it should be a record of, in 8 hours, you had 1.37 crore registrations. So it's a huge system. And now, and you know, the number of total number of registrations as of now, let me just go to the dashboard and I'll tell you, total registrations are 15,93,69,204. And today's registrations are 7,87,225. So we have a dashboard which basically, you know, just gives the real-time figures. It's called dashboard.covin.gov.in. That's the way it basically comes. So it's a very transparent system. You can see the number of vaccinations being done each district-wise, each state-wise, the age-wise vaccination, the vaccine-wise vaccination figures. So everything is available on the portal. It's available, and maybe I don't know whether this system has got, but otherwise I can also, you know, show how the platform looks like. Maybe you can also log in and you can show to your viewers how the system looks like.
Absolutely, sir. I'm also reminded of this study or this protocol that you had in Jharkhand, keeping in the pandemic situation that in mind. It was said that facial recognition will help alleviate the concerns of accidental infections at the vaccination centers. What are the plans ahead? Are you going to implement it throughout the country?
See, the term which was used by the media is actually a wrong term. You use the term called facial recognition. Now, facial recognition basically implies that I capture your face and then search in a gallery of faces to figure out that you are Kriti Mishra. That is facial recognition. Now, we are not using facial recognition. We are using facial authentication. Now, the difference in authentication and recognition is as follows. Now, for example, if I take your fingerprint and I ask the system whose fingerprints are they, that will be called fingerprint recognition. But if I take your fingerprint and ask the question, are these fingerprints of Kriti Mishra or are these fingerprints of R.S. Sharma? Then the answer will be yes and no. Basically, if the fingerprints are your fingerprints and I ask, is it Kriti Mishra's fingerprints, then they will say yes. That is called authentication. Now, we have been since the beginning doing authentication and not recognition. Now, this authentication is done in Aadhaar, as you know. It is done on fingerprint. It is done on iris. It is also done on OTP-based authentication, which means that you plug in your number and then, for example, you file your income tax return, then you put your PAN card number, which is linked to Aadhaar, and Aadhaar system now sends a mobile number, which is linked to your Aadhaar number. And once you plug in that mobile number, then we know that, yes, it is you who is filling the income tax return. So basically, it is just to authenticate that you are you. Not really find out as to who you are. There is a substantial difference. So what we are doing in Jharkhand is essentially now besides the fingerprint and the what is called the iris and the OTP, the UIDAI is also piloting what is called the facial auth, which means that we say that this is Kriti Mishra and your face is captured and the answer is yes it is. Or it is not. Okay. This auth is similar to other kinds of authentications, except that it does not require any touch. It's a touchless authentication. That is what we have been kind of doing the proof of concept and pilot in Jharkhand. Now, obviously, that will depend on the policy of the UIDAI, what it wants to do. But we will just give the data of the success, failure, other kinds of difficulties to the UIDAI after the successful pilot.
But sir, from certain quarters, there were concerns of data security, as you said, on facial authentication and not recognition.
No, the data security concerns are there in almost every kind of data when you keep it, right? Facial authentication, we are not capturing and the UIDAI is not keeping the face. Facial authentication works on a certain techniques. It's like, when you do a fingerprint authentication, your raw images of the fingerprints do not go to the UIDAI server. So similarly, UIDAI does not keep your fingerprints images. So it is just a one-to-one match. Now, one-to-one match does not create any privacy concerns, number one. Number two, UIDAI does not know for what purpose you are doing the authentication. There are certain things. This whole thing has been debated for a long time before the Honorable Supreme Court. And it has been declared that authentication does not create any privacy concerns. And that's the declaration by the Honorable Supreme Court, the highest court of this land. So therefore, I think there are certain people whose job it is to just, keep on raising some frivolous kind of concerns which have no basis whatsoever. They just have a very, a paranoia, so to say. I have written in my book also the perpetual paranoia. So this is what they do. They have, quite successfully demonized and have actually succeeded in demonizing Aadhaar, one of the most beautiful, work which this country has done and other countries are looking to replicate it. They are, many people have just demonized that identity. It has been a game changer. It has, enabled direct benefit transfers. It has done many things, but anyway, today we are not speaking about Aadhaar, but about COVID.
All right, so all the concerns are allayed. But sir, private players during, of course, phase three and establishments will be allowed to procure vaccine doses from manufacturers exclusively from the 50% supply earmarked for doses other than the ones for the government. How has been the deliberation with the private entities?
My job is very clearly defined, which is to maintain the COVID platform, construct the COVID platform, and ensure that it is secure, safe, data security is there, it is convenient to the people to use, it is able to record vaccinations, it is able to provide all kinds of analytics to the policy makers, for example, the AEFI, the adverse impact figures, which we collect at the time of vaccination, they are now subjected to all analysis. So we will be able to figure out as to which vaccine is producing what kind of adverse impacts and all that analytics. So that is my job. And I am focusing only on to that job. I think this job itself is also quite, I will not use the word challenging, but it's quite a risky job because every time I am worried that, you know, things may not work. And you know, when the report came at 4 p.m. that the system has crashed, I had a very, you know, really difficult time of the about first half an hour till I figured out that it is not a crash and people are just making up things.
Right, sir. Okay. Lastly, sir, you talked about analysis. So what kind of analysis now that we'll have private vaccines, we may also have international vaccines. What kind of analysis will COVID do now?
No, the COVID has been doing, COVID has been doing all kinds of analysis in the sense the data which is there. And actually, this analysis is not limited to the government doing the analysis. The dashboard, which is actually very transparent dashboard, which provides all kinds of data to the people. People can also do an analysis. So that's the whole purpose is that once you have so much of data and that data, part of that data is obviously personally sensitive data, which is not going to be exposed to the people. But part of the data is statistical data, which is basically data of numbers, how many people were vaccinated at what centers, which vaccine, what are the kinds of adverse reactions. These are all public data. These are all anonymized data. They don't violate anybody's privacy. And those data are useful data from the perspective of analysis. So I don't do the analysis, but the many, you know, other research bodies involved in this process, they are doing analysis and they are actually figuring out their own conclusions. And then those data help in policy making for further. Mm-hmm. You know, for example, the data as to how many people of 18 to 44 age groups have registered, how many people are there who have been vaccinated, and we need to ensure that second dose for those people is available on a priority basis. All those issues are issues of policy making. And we believe in data-driven policy making. So basically, you have more data, probably you make much more accurate and good policy. So that's the use of this kind of data.
Lastly, Mr. Sharma, before we end this conversation, what is your message to people of this country, to, of course, people who are looking for jabs in this phase three vaccination drive?
Well, I'm too small a person to give any message to the people of this country. I'm not really capable and competent of that. Only thing which
you're being very modest. You're being very modest.
My limited experience is that, you know, that I think people should, without hesitation, go for jabs, go for vaccination, because that is one of the most potent weapons in our hands to vaccinate, to get vaccines. And I think the way we are proceeding, I think we will be able to accelerate this process. The third phase is fairly liberalized phase, and I think we will see acceleration. Of course, it may be a little delayed. Some people, some states may get the vaccine on first itself and they will start vaccinating on first 18 to 44 years. Some states may get it a little later, they will come on board a little later. So it may not be that everybody will start vaccinating on first itself. Yes. But the point is that, you know, the platform is ready and you can, you know, run your train as early as you want to run that train on this platform. Thank
absolutely, you very much. Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Sir, pleasure talking to you and thank you so much for answering all our queries.
Thank you very much for having me on Rajya Sabha TV.
Thanks a lot, sir.
We'll be right back.